The Cheshire Cat's Eye, a Sharon McCone mystery by Marcia Muller, narrated by Laura Hicks. Chapter 1. The row of Victorian houses loomed dark in the early June fog. I put my hand on the cold iron railing and started up the stairway from the street. As I pushed through the overgrown front yard, blackberry vines reached out to tear at my clothing. Strange, I thought, that there were no lights. The houses were under renovation, but surely Jake would have brought a flashlight to the one where he had asked me to meet him. I went up the marble porch steps and felt for a doorbell. Nothing. Finally, I got out my pencil flash and shone its beam around the leaded glass doors. The bell hung on wires, broken. I started to knock, and the door swung inward. I paused in the high-ceilinged vestibule. There was no sound. Maybe my friend had gotten tired of waiting. I was later than I'd said I would be. I decided to see if he'd left me a note. I went through an arch and crossed the parlor toward the back of the house. Behind it was another room with an ornate fireplace, and beyond that, another archway and blackness. I stepped through the archway and waited for my eyes to become accustomed to the dark. When they were, I inched toward a faintly outlined door at the rear. My foot hit something soft. The back of my neck prickled. I turned on the flash again. It went out. I punched the faulty switch harder and shone the beam down, at the floor, at a man's prone body. I recoiled, my heart pounding. "Jake," I whispered. "Oh, no, Jake." Even at a glance, even in this light, I could tell my friend was dead. He lay on his side in what common sense told me must be blood, only it didn't smell like blood. My fingers clutched the flash. I stood for a moment, several moments. It seemed like hours. Finally, I knelt and dipped my finger into the pool of liquid. It was thick and sticky. Paint. Bright red house paint. I straightened, wiping my finger on my jeans before I realized what I was doing. "Oh, Jake," I said, louder. My words echoed in the cavernous room, and then the old house enveloped me in ponderous silence. From outside came the bellow of foghorns on San Francisco Bay. I backed toward the wall, my eyes still on the body, and fumbled with a light switch. Nothing happened. When I cast my flash at the high ceiling, it illuminated an ornate plaster rosette, but no fixture. The big Victorian had obviously been stripped. Still, I didn't need a second look to make sure who the paint-smeared victim was. Jake Kaufman, the friend who had so urgently requested I meet him here. My flashlight showed enough of his tanned face and black hair to identify him. Any closer investigation, I'd leave for the police. I backtracked to the hallway, glad to escape the presence of the corpse. Why, I thought, would anyone want to kill a gentleman like Jake Kaufman? And why had he insisted we meet in this deserted house? Stepping onto the porch, I spotted a phone booth on the far corner below. I ran down the steps and through the maze of wild vegetation to the stairway that scaled the retaining wall between there and the street. By the time I reached the booth, my heart was pounding again. Reflexively, I checked my watch. It was 9 p.m. I dialed the SFPD and asked for Greg Marcus, head of homicide. The lieutenant was off duty. Did I want to leave a message? No, I'd call him at home. I fished in my bag for my address book and redialed. He answered on the first ring. "Greg," I said, "it's Sharon McCone."
"Hey, how's my favorite private eye?"
"Not so good, Greg. I found a friend of mine, murdered." There was a pause.
"Aren't you a little corpse-happy lately?"
He was referring to two murder cases that I'd recently been involved with in his jurisdiction. "Greg, I'm not kidding."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.